I'm not saying local versus mono local, we're just saying the difference. And this is kind of the big message of the local pertaining to the business sector, is the dollars you spend at a local business and how that's spent, right? So, you spend $100 at a local business, $40 stays with you. There's lots of different studies of how that works, right? So, if Heidi has a local business, I'm going to hire you as my bookkeeper, and I'm going to give you $20 of my $100. So I need to have someone fix my book. And then I'm going to hire you for another $20 because you're going to do some of my marketing and you're going to make me a logo for my business. And then I'm going to hire you to help me deliver all my food, right? When those things happen, that's money in your pocket. It helps support your business. And you're spending it in the community as well, okay? If we're thinking about spending that $100 at somewhere else, only $13 of that money stays in our local economy. That money goes elsewhere because those head offices, those accountants, those marketers, all those kind of things don't actually live. So, we're saying local business has three times the local economic impact. Some of the other studies that are out there, and we do a lot in the food area at Eat Local First too, we're trying to show with trying to build a food hub in Edmonton. Where are the distribution points and kind of the connector to local businesses. So something as simple, I'm going to give you a story about yogurt. So I had to deal with yogurt business. So a very big, I'm going to say, conference center in town. Thinking about doing health breaks, what they call them now. You know, your coffee break is now health break. And they want to use a local yogurt supplier. Okay, so how do you make this happen? Because they're not going to go to the local yogurt supplier. They want to make this easy. But they want to have a lot of yogurt. So my yogurt guy doesn't have a lot of yogurt. And he doesn't make the little yogurt. So he's thinking about making the little yogurt, but he can't get that price point down. So the big conference center, very close by here, will buy it. So this is how we start. We're trying to connect the dots and say, okay, would you consider initially paying this price point for his little yogurt? Because if he could get this contract, that will turn his business around. Because right now he's kind of, okay, I kind of can make it, but if I start doing that, and then they don't buy from me again, I've made this little container, which is a little more work than the big container, and then what, right? So we're trying to be the connection point as well, beyond the food delivery. It's saying you can support local business, especially some of our larger entities in town, and this is what it might take. Make a longer term commitment. Just buy yogurt from a local guy and buy yogurt from him for a year so he can actually make that sustainable, right? So that's a little jump that some organizations have to make to say, we support local people. And then we see the economic trickle down to that. That means he hires more staff, he has to hire, not hire, he has to have more dairy cows, things like that, and all those things trickle down and produces more work, more economy, all that kind of stuff. So, I talked about this before, the increased multiplier effect, more money stays in the community, it's passed around longer in our community, there's reduced leakage, leakage in our community, but less money leaving our community. Locally independent businesses impact our community in a more positive way than non-local or chain franchise preferences. A lot of our local businesses, and I know a lot of them, they sit on committees, they contribute to community life, they donate more to nonprofits. So that's one of the things. I would say a great example in my neighborhood is we revitalized our park. And I would say the local businesses, I will point out the Edmonton Center, made a confident personal effort to make sure there's enough money to basically do nearly $1 million to revitalize our community park, the abandoned closure. That was huge. I think that really turned our neighborhood around. Now there's West Prime, all those kind of things, but it's really the gathering place for the children, for adults, for community events, you know, offer there, there's so much. That's good stuff, right? And that was community effort, but business effort as well. I don't know how to make that go away.
Escape.
Escape. Escape, okay. I escape over here. So these are some of the outcomes of local business: increased economic impact, diversify local economy, more jobs, kind of the social, the higher civic engagement, enhanced community character, sense of place, residents rooted in community. On the environment, shorter supply lines, reduced sprawl, reduced transportation needs, ability to create vibrant local communities. So this is Nicola from Irving Farm, and she sells pork. And I would say she has some of the best pork products in my world, and she's one of our suppliers. And she's established pork producer. And they started here, I think 6 years ago. They started at the downtown farmers market, and now they're supporting local restaurants and things like that. And so if you think about it, in Alberta we spend 9.9 billion in supermarkets and grocery stores. 10% of that went to local farmers. What would that mean? Right? That's a lot of money, right? If more restaurants are serving local food, if it was easier to access. So if that yogurt from the smaller producers would be easier to access and get into the supply chain, I can tell you, local food supply chain is hard to get with. This is Jen. She runs Lux Boutique in Heidi Street, 124th, 125th Street. There's a whole bunch of local businesses there. Some of them are members, locals, and some others. And she has a beauty boutique. And so, yes, people spending at her store versus some of the other places, it's really important to her. Right? Then she can hire and she can make this business work. She's only 2 years in. Spend $61 billion in Asia. That's a lot of money. And then dine local. And I know many of you know some fabulous, Edmonton has fabulous local restaurants. And a lot of them also support our local farmers because they procure from local farmers to make some of the fabulous dishes. I think it's more and more accessible. And you've got to have that, and that's better because that's better work for them. The Red Option is out there in French. So how do we get people to spend here? We talk like this. But it's also about changing your consciousness of how you spend your dollars. And it's a conscious decision that you make quite easy in your habits, where you buy your coffee, where you bring out your family to dinner, when you go to the farmer's market, all those kinds of things. So, we talked a lot about what we do. And we support our businesses by doing bank stuff for people, websites of all the different events and programs they have. Well, things like this. We dine local. We do dining festivals like pork festivals, what have you. We also are one of the few groups that actually help all the local restaurants. We actually have a benefit fund because it actually keeps those great chefs and those great food chefs and waiters, and they actually have a benefit program. It's not a high paying job. So we do that collectively so that small business can have a benefit. We do all these things, especially this month. This is the truck. If you order local food, it comes to your door. They're running around your neighborhood. We also give back. So 1% of our gross profits, we give back to a community agency, and they buy local food from us and we deliver it to our home. We also do a work local program where we do job sharing among jobs in the restaurants. A lot of our restaurants share employees. A lot of our retail organizations, retail operations, they share employees. We're trying to help support people to have full-time work. And good employees are much prime, but not all businesses can support having 6 full-time employees. So we do a lot in setting up those relationships. Anyway, that's my presentation. My colleague Jesse is the founder. She's on stage. And she had this vision probably around 9 years ago. She started an organization called the Original Fair, which was a group of local restaurants. And now, how many years later, we're functioning social enterprise? 2 years in, open to stay sustainable. Good morning. Thank you.
Are there any questions for Heidi?
How far ahead do you have to order your food? You're going to get the delivery?
We have the next day delivery. So you can order Monday night till midnight, and I'll deliver it to you the next day. Not me personally, but I happen to want to deliver. That's it. So we deliver Tuesday, Wednesday, Thursday, Friday.
So does Live Local network with comparable organizations in other cities? Like, is there...
We're part of a group called Bali, which is a group in the United States. That's where Desi actually is. And there's a lot of, especially in the States, there's a lot of movement about local economy issues. And so we are a member of that. But there's these organizations in Vancouver, and Halifax has one as well. So a lot of the organizations are organizing around an issue, revitalizing a downtown, or changing some sort of policy or bylaw that's happening in their community, especially in the States. So, a lot of communities are businesses that use this kind of model for community revitalization.
Is Live Local a peer organization, peer-to-peer organization? In other words, they work on the initiatives as the volunteers in the business community, or do they contribute in some way to hire professional people to facilitate business development?
So our members pay membership fee, and therefore we can hire staff for that membership fee to do collective marketing on behalf of the business. But pertaining to all those groups, they organize. So they meet and organize what kind of initiative they want to look at. So especially the dying local groups, they were the ones who said, we need a dining festival in Edmonton. Everybody else does it, why aren't we doing that, right? And so that's how they got themselves on the map, right? So they're looking always collectively. The producers do. We meet collectively with them, and they have decision making power.
Actually, I was just wondering, does Live Local do anything to promote, like, urban gardening or backyard gardening? The reason I ask, like, in our neighborhood of Macaulay, when we moved there 30 years ago, I would say a lot of people had backyard gardens, and we're now one of the few. And I know that there is a lot of organization around the community gardens, which is wonderful. But I just kind of wondered, or do you partner with somebody who's doing that?
No, we don't.
So that's not one that you've taken on, okay?
No, we don't take that one on, but we do support it, right?
Right, of course, yeah.
There are groups that are doing that.
You can't get any more local than your backyard.
Well, that's true, right? Yeah.
It was just an idea that I'm throwing out because I mean, there is a really strong community garden movement, which is great for people who live in apartments and high rises and so on, and that's an increasing percentage of us, but for people. Because I was thinking, like, the community's in bloom, right? I mean, and all those wonderful pictures you see, but it's all, kind of non-edible stuff, right? And so somebody to kind of champion that locally. Yeah. Let me just pitch that idea to you, Heidi.
Well, I mean, and here's our balance. We're a social enterprise. We have to make money as a business. Crazy, right? And so you're always trying to balance that advocacy side of things with, I have to go back to work and blow coolers this afternoon. Right, so we do this stuff, and we try to sell membership, and we sell food, right? And how you do that wholesale and to direct customers is a nice balance, right? Because the food issue and those kind of things are also part of this larger issue.
Maybe what we need a new urban farmer in Edmonton.
Yeah, we
could
use that.
Ron Barathan was a neighbor of ours. Yeah. He's relocated actually out to the West Coast, unfortunately.
Yeah.
Anyway.
Yeah. And I have a lot of people who they order from us for certain things, but they're the canners and gardeners as well. So gardener people are definitely part of business, and they buy things as well for products that they can't grow or hold. Yeah. Not a long enough growing season for certain things.
What would you say your major challenges are or obstacles are for your objectives?
For local food, the biggest challenge is competition with the global food market. I'd say it shouldn't be there. And then the local food system is broken. What I mean by broken is, it's like my yogurt story. To get that yogurt to that guy without using some of the big guys like the Cisco and those people is virtually impossible. Price point is different. We can't do it, nor do we try to. Right? So rebuilding the local food system, including that, you know, you can't grow your own food in your backyard thing, is a huge challenge. So some of the work it takes just to get local food, local meat out the door is a huge challenge for us. Right? So working with producers to get some of the skill, plus the resources to scale up, is a hard challenge, and I would say something fairly political here. And there's not always provision for it.
I was just going to ask that question. Do you see the Department of Agriculture and that, are they very effective in
They just recently released a really good study on what we can do to improve the local food system. Putting it into action and putting your money where your mouth is another story. So that train has already left the building in their world. And there's many people working on this issue, but it's a long haul. So the money invested in the subsidy is going to the global market. You get a heck of a lot more money to sell beef in Europe right now than you would to sell local food in Edmonton, for lack of a better word. For the business side, it's, you know, small business owners are jack of all trades. They're the bookkeeper, they're the marketer, they're the person opening the box and filling the shelf. So, but fine, for a lot of people, it's hard for them to find the time to weigh in and do some of it if they want to. And then just learning how to market. I have a whole bunch of farmers and they want to do social media. Oh, you know, so we do social media, you know, Twitter and all that. Like, you know, you got to get on that train, right? But it's a challenge to have enough time and resources and resilience to do all this stuff, right? So, you know, small business owners have a challenge. Right? And then staffing. A lot of people need work. Finding the right fit for your small business is hard. Sometimes because the business owner is an exception for wonderful person too, that's not for him, but still hard. People need good staff at a small business, and they're always challenged with this.
I hate to put you on the spot, but what's your take so far on the city's preliminary work, admittedly, on the citywide food and agricultural policy, and how it relates to this
issue?
Just among friends.
Among friends? You know, I think it's the right, you know, I think the city is taking great strides in listening to the different groups who really try to shape that, and I think that will be happening in that. So, yeah. Big plans to save the northeast corner would be nice, given that I buy a lot of food from there for the good food box, and we need it. But I think for me personally, let's hurry, right? Let's get going, right? Because there's a lot of groups there, especially if you're trying to do the food hub style thing, where those initiatives need to show some outcome for us to continue to get funding and business. Right? So, you know, we start these things and the outcomes take a long time. It takes 10 years to do those connection points. And, I would like to see some teeth in city policy for procurement practices of where you got to buy your food. So, we got a big conference center, more plans. You know, different organizations are fun. They could buy local food and they go. They do a little. They don't enough.
I'm not sure we could control them, but we could try to handle them.
Yeah, exactly. And that's where, my yogurt story is one where it's like, this would mean something. But if they had, so another example is the public school board is a protest saying, we want healthier food. Kids eat this. Why? Tastes like potato chips, but it's healthy for them. And so we actually have a school cafeteria. Who's going to try all these for us? Right? There's a lot of other wonderful products that aren't made from Coca-Cola or things like that. And so there's some cafeteria, and in Ontario, they've shifted a lot of the school board, actually have done this thing. We're going to buy 10% university supplements. Our cafeteria is going to have 10% local. And if you get those contracts, I can scale a lot of farms up. right? So they can scale themselves up. They'll have the opportunity and the turnaround to do that, right? We don't have a lot of case examples of that happening. Irving's would be an example of one who did it well. A lot of people are just going, but if they get 50% bigger, you know, how do I hire staff and get there, right?
Yeah.
Yeah, how do you tip them over, right? A couple contracts don't tip them over, right? Not tons of money, right? But it's labor, all the things. So.
You should be aware, and others may be interested to know, that the 2012 work to complete the citywide food and agriculture strategy is currently unfunded in the budget that was just released 2 hours ago. So if you have an interest and opinion in that, you may want to communicate that back through your networks.
Okay.
So, and the public hearing on the budget is November 25th. Anyway, I didn't come here to advocate.
Oh, but that's, no. That's good to know, so and it's in our circle, because we have some well-placed farmers in the city limits, or shortly out, who do make an economic impact, and they would be bothered to know that.
Mm-hmm. I would, too.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Any other questions?
What kind of a message would you convey to those living on low income and they feel compelled to shop at the Walmart?
You know, here's the thing, is that's fine. You have to live within your means, right? Local food is more expensive. If I was low income, I could buy it. It's cheaper to get my cheaper food like that. And so you can provide for your family with new stuff, right? And so that's the irony of the situation, right? Is that food right outside our door, our potatoes up here, and people are relying on food. There's something wrong with that, isn't it? Right? So this is not you have to. It's those who can to think about it, right? This isn't a state religion. But again, it's a little bit of shifting. Think about what you're doing with your dollar. It does make an impact. It does have to be done, right? If I look at my office, I've hired all interns or people from different agencies to create a point. And that's huge, right? They now have jobs, right? And we made a choice to do that for a land. We can hire all interns. It's also helpful because we get government funding. We can. And you know, some hired from Mennonites and other places like that because we want to do that. So I've got a lot of people who now have employment, who didn't have employment. First jobs in Canada, things like that. It's a lot of fun, right?
I'm kind of conflicted in that I like to buy local, so Costco sells Alberta potatoes, cucumbers, tomatoes, so, you know, Costco is a big guy, and yet they're buying local. And
that's fine. There's no, you have to be a purist, right? Those potatoes might be even better or more pure if you think you bought them from the Italian place, because that actually is a local business. But, you know, I'm not reporting one way or the other, right? It's about, you know, thinking about it, right? So many of us go to Costco, and yes, they are serving local, and good for them, right? They're helping, right? In a bigger way than definitely not at our.
Thank you so thanks for coming today and both coming up today. Thank you all for coming. Thank you for Heidi. Really interesting talk on local economy. Thanks also to the Edmonton Public Library for allowing us to host this event here today. So our next lunch and will be on January 26th, and we'll consider Wendy Pepperis and Jonah Grad from the Center for Family Literacy. They'll be talking about a ESG-determined topic associated with family literacy in Alberta and what they do with the as I mentioned before, please drop off your lunch and learn survey just at 40 minutes. And also just take a look at the brochures that the Planning Council has on our tables and brochures that Heidi has left out on the table behind you. So thanks again for coming today, and we look forward to seeing you in the new year. Take care.
Thank you.